I'll take a quick moment to introduce Bhaktivinoda Swami. He's obviously not a new person here. We've seen Maharaj for many decades serving in our Toronto community. But for those of you who may not know Bhaktivinoda Maharaj, he's also known as the Walking Monk. He was introduced to the Bhakti tradition by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. He is famously known for his lively and rocking musical meditation. You would have just witnessed it some time back with Kirtan. And he also does live community theater production. He's a director, script writer, and he loves connecting with people whenever he goes on his adventurous walks. And so far, he's completed more than 4 times walking coast to coast across Canada, and he extensively travels in South America as well. And after a break, after a while, we are having His Holiness Bhaktivinoda Swami at the Toronto Temple. So we're very grateful, Maharaj, that you could be here with us this evening. Thank you so much. And yes, please welcome Maharaj once again. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much. Hare Krishna. I'm choosing to stand here and walk around and pace a little bit today because of our little special thing that was mentioned. So, Keshava Dharita Rama Sharira Jaya Jagadish Hare. We take shelter of Ramachandra. He's one of the prime incarnations or avatars in our tradition. I'll start off by, first of all, offering respects to our Guru Maharaj. Namo Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutare Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swamini Dhaname Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Desha Dhaline Hare Krishna. Jai. So we will try to. Yesterday I went for a walk in Rosedale, in that area. And there was a little basketball court there. There were a couple of young guys, a few actually, maybe a dozen or so, doing their best to strike, to score, and they were doing pretty good. Right next to them was a man named Hare Krishna, sitting on the park bench, and I just kind of acknowledged him, thank you, and he said it again, Hare Krishna! And he went to the boys who were at the basketball court, said, this is Hare Krishna. They're peaceful people. They give the best food. You should go try their food sometime. Okay. So I went to him and I just said, okay, today it's really Hare Rama, because just around the corner is the appearance day of Sri Ramachandra. And he's one of the great avatars. Everybody knows that term avatar. We've heard it many times before, right? And somebody stole it from us. Okay. I'm just going to take a verse from the 9th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. The story of Ram is there in a synopsis form. And if you really want to get into the details of Ramachandra's pastimes, then you can look to Valmiki Ramayana. Valmiki is the person who actually scripted or got all the, got scribed the stories, the pastimes of Ramachandra, which are actually glorious. But in a synopsis form, we find it in the Bhagavatam. And this is the 9th canto, chapter 10, the pastimes of Lord Ramachandra. And I'm just going to choose 2 or 3 verses to speak from, and we're not going to take so much time because we have a short drama to present to you today. It's a special treat. Okay, so text 13. After reached the beach, Lord Ramachandra fasted for 3 days, awaiting the arrival of the ocean personified. When the ocean did not come, the Lord exhibited his pastimes of anger. And simply by his glancing over the ocean, all the living entities within it, including the crocodiles and sharks, were agitated by fear. Then the personified ocean fearfully approached Lord Ramachandra, taking all paraphernalia to worship him. Following at the Lord's lotus feet, the personified ocean spoke as follows. And here we go, this is the main verse. O all-pervading Supreme Person, we are dull-minded and did not understand who you are. But now we understand that you are the Supreme Person, the master of the entire universe, the unchanging and original personality of Godhead. The demigods are infatuated with the mode of goodness, the Prajapatis with the mode of passion, and the Lord of Ghosts with the mode of ignorance. But you are the master of all these qualities. Hare Krishna. So a little bit on the background of this. As you know, Ravan, who represents, he's the epitome of evil. He had kidnapped the consort of Ramachandra and took her to his land of monopoly, Sri Lanka. And so to do that, he had this mystical conveyance, and with it he could fly in the air. And so it just happened that when Ram had gained allies, such as Hanuman, Angad, an army of monkeys, as well as a bear by the name of Jambavan, and a few, like a vulture, Sampati, and others, they attempted to help. They felt sorry for Ram, and they wanted to assist in rescuing Sita. So the attempt was made. They went south in India and to a place called Rameshwara. Did anybody ever go there before? I did. Did you get wet?
Yes.
Okay, you go and they with your clothes on and everything. And then you go in the ocean. You should. Well, that's what I did. And I spent a long time there because it's such a sacred place. When Ram and his army reached the ocean, it was impassable for them, at least for a time. They expected that the ocean, the Samudra, would cooperate with them. But he didn't. And there's a couple of stories about how the ocean was impudent and stubborn and not cooperating whatsoever. The story that Prabhupada tells of the sparrow who lost her eggs to the ocean. The wave came and, like a minor tsunami, I guess, took her eggs, a nest of eggs, and she was furious. And she threatened the ocean, bring back my eggs or else. Or else what? Or else I'll dry you up. So the ocean was very stubborn and obstinate, just started to scream with laughter. Oh my God, this is ridiculous. And the sparrow started drinking, pecking away, and he laughed even louder. Then Garuda, the great eagle bird, the supporter of Vishnu, he actually flew, and he was hearing all this commotion down below, and he thought, I'll investigate. So he landed on the sand at the edge of the ocean. He said, what's wrong, Sister Bird here? She said, the ocean has taken my eggs, and I demand to have them back, and the ocean is not cooperating, so I threaten him, I'm going to dry him up. So Garuda, who's always in helpful mode, is like a superhero. He just stood there, stout and strong, and he, with his wing, pointed out to the ocean, you bring back those eggs or I'll dry you up. And the ocean in the mood of, oops, here you go, brought back the eggs, and the sparrow went really telling a story of determination, then was satisfied. So determination gets you to places. Here's another story of where the Indian Ocean didn't, let's say, cooperate with Ram. Ram was simply asking, we need to cross, and the ocean was not cooperating. Ram got really angry. Anger is justified in many cases. Krishna was angry with Arjuna when Arjuna was not acting appropriately, or his mindset was not proper. And so Krishna more or less said, that's how Prabhupada puts it, you are fool number one. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also got angry when his associate Nityananda was abused physically by two, let's say, upstarts, Jagai and Madai. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was very angry and he released his divine weapon. But Nityananda was very kind, said, no, let's not go that route. Let's not get violent. I mean, after all, you've come here, you're a patita pavana, you're a peacemaker, peacekeeper. So let's not BA violent and something like that. And then also, we hear the story about Hanuman. Everybody knows Hanuman. He also demonstrated heroism, and he was extremely angry that Ravana had taken away Sita. So in the mood of Hanuman, everyone was trying to help to rescue Sita. The interesting thing about the Ramayana, much like the Mahabharata, the other epic that is so dear to us, everything centers around the abuse of a fine woman, in this case it was Sita, and in the Mahabharata it was the case of Draupadi being dishonored. And that's what basically started the war. Something has to kick people off. Something has to get everything. Somebody has to trigger. And people have to take hits too. And the hits should be with the villains. In this case, it's Ravana. He was not a nice guy. He was just not a nice guy. That's all. He was a formidable person, but his Brahmanism was misdirected. You know, so his domain was in Sri Lanka, as you know. Anybody ever been there? That was exotic land. Well, that's pretty good. I've been invited a few times, but haven't made it there just yet. Maybe I'll walk on the causeway over the sea. That's how the Lanki army actually got across. They made their way over to the ocean. And just with the help of Ram, the ocean in the end cooperated and everything was fine and dandy. So once again, Krishna, who in many incarnations and forms and avatars, always is there to help people. He's especially there to help the soft-hearted folks. And in chapter 4 of the Bhagavad Gita, the Lord actually explains that. He actually says, Paritranai sadhanam vinashikacha dushkritam dharma samstapanarataya samamami yuge yuge. Chapter 4 tells us why Krishna comes to the world. He comes here to help those people who have some of the highest qualities. Then for those who are not so pious, he subdues them. He says, hush, shum, shush. You know, sometimes he gives some motion. He's very kind. And then the last reason for his coming into this world is to establish dharma. Now that peace has been established, he says, let's keep the peace and let's do it by people just following their dharma, which means to follow your natural, cycle, physical nature, right? So that's very important. And so when it comes to the Ramayana, the story of Ram, and the story of Krishna, you can tie these stories of the Ramayana and the Mahabharata together. For instance, right in the beginning of the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna comes in, Krishna's the chariot driver, and there's the kapitvaj, the flag of Hanuman, that decorates the chariot of Arjuna. So there's this connection. Sita, by the way, Janak, is her father, a very pious king. And he's also mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita as somebody that we can follow, a role model. And there's other references. In the chapter 4 again, if I get referred to that, Krishna says that the knowledge that I first imparted to the sun god long ago was then transmitted to the sun god, from the sun god to the Manu, the father of mankind, and then Manu to Ikshvaku, and Ikshvaku was one of those pious kings once again who appeared in the Raghu dynasty. That's the dynasty of Ram. Okay, so these two personalities that we chant so much about, Krishna and Ram, are very dear to us. And of all the leelas or pastimes of the different avatars, I think there's a lot of parallels there. They're very sweet, they're very charming. And we can learn about them. And chapter 17, from text number 16, there's some key hints as to what you do about a troubled mind. Does anybody here have a troubled mind from time to time? Anybody? The mind is stormy. How about all the time? Most of the time? Just to be on the same side. So that's very true. So what do you do about that? fill it. The mind loves to take impressions. It loves to absorb, take data in, and it can be good or bad. So Prabhupada offers in this purport a suggestion, what you can do about the unstable mind. Fill it up with beautiful stories, beautiful pastimes of Rama and Krishna and so on. Stories from the Mahabharata and the Ramayana Puranas. A lot of ancient stories out there. Stories about heroism and how to overcome difficulties. After all, we're human, so we have a lot of problems. We're struggling all the time. Prakriti, Sani, Kaisati. That's explained in Bhagavad Gita. Everyone's struggling with the six senses, including the mind, right? Mind is a real troublemaker. I wish we could do something. I want to strangle it sometimes. You know? So, but that's one way that we can overcome these problems, okay? By filling our minds and our hearts with these leelas, these pastimes. So I think what we're going to have to do is we're going to just move on to the next part of the program. So I have written a book called The Saffron Path, and it's about the walks that I did across Canada and the U.S. and other places. But we're coming out with a new one on some of the poetry we've written, and it's called Poems 1. So there will be part 2, 3, 4, hopefully. And one of those poems, I thought, why don't we enact it? Why don't we just act it out? So we got the idea the other day. I'm here in Canada, I just came from South Africa, Mauritius and India, but here I'm in my home base. So I want to offer something nice to Ram and to the Ram Bhaktas here. So I just mentioned to some of our young folks here, and they said, yeah, I'm on board, okay? So that's it. We're going to give credits to those who are in the play. No special sound effects, except for what I might put on the microphone. I'm going to sit right about where you are. So I'm sorry about that. But okay. And then we will do a new presentation. It's fresh, hot off the press. Okay? I just have my goodies here, and I was supposed to give some gifts out here. Some gifts. Okay, tell me which place was Ram born?
Ayodhya.
You all said it at the same time. I can't divide this picture here. Okay. Who lives near Ayodhya or came from nearby? Ayodhya. Okay, I'll just what was the name of Sita's father?
Three.
I was thinking about three to three. What?
Three.
Sorry. Another good one.
Three.
Go repeat it. When we say Hari Ram, Hari Ram, it actually also indicates Sri Ramachandra. Okay? Great. Let's see. What's another one now? Okay. What's the, how many heads did so and so have?
Ten.
Ten. Talk about Ravana, Hare Krishna, that's an easy one. We didn't want to make it too complicated for you. Okay, great, so we'll get you to applaud soon. Just a minute. We'll give credits at the end. Thank you so much. I'll just sit right over here. And I'll need a little stand, a short stand, if that's okay. A stand. So we are our entertainers, they just made themselves ready. Entertainers, hello. Everyone's dressed like, you know, French actors a la carte. Okay, so here we've got the poem is called Ron, and with your applause, the entertainers will come forward. Doug, sing it out for me. We're asking people to refrain from getting back there. Thank you. Okay, here we go. Ron possesses all the qualities of a superhero. Royal traits of ultimate prince, monarch, or pharaoh. Reverent to all, eager to help and listen, with a service attitude, acting on what's given. His build is admirable, countenance grave, tasks he tackles meant only for the brave. He never moves suddenly at a reckless whim. No wonder his father, the emperor, adores him. Ron is a heartthrob for many a woman. He also has a striking brother with the name Lakshman. Of all ladies, lovely Sita won Ron in a tournament. These three leave an indelible mark, a footprint, literally so, on the forest floor at Chitrakoot. In a fateful exile, they meet an ogress, not cute. Smitten with desire, the ogress solicits Ron. He declares loyalty, not yielding to this love bomb. This invokes a fury in the lustful jungle lady, who attacks Sita, for all she does is shaking. Lakshman draws his dagger, making a clean cut. Off comes nose and ears, disfiguring her somewhat. The wounded ogress flees to gain retaliation.
Get him!
14,000 aggressive ogres assail, adding aggravation. Ron single-handedly put their lives to completion. The ogress reaches her cannibal king Ravana to petition. In revenge, this ten-headed villain uses trickery and hoax. A mystic becomes a golden deer who goes to coax fair Sita away from the guard of her husband. Ram's plot triumphs, stealing Sita, Ram's diamond. To Isle of Lanka, he flies with captive Sita by his side. Devastated is Ram with his loved companion denied. A vulture, a bear, a monkey offer solace. As allies, they pledge to regain the goddess. Battles are conflicts to avoid, if possible, when negotiations fail, with the bridges not crossable. Speaking of bridges, Monkey Hanuman cleared the ocean with one leap to Lanka on the strength of devotion.
Yes, you know.
Crossing the new causeway, now the means to go, is a Scythian army wielding weapons. For Ron, it's a bow. A clash between mean man and monkey is a fierce fight. Casualties are many, as all exhibits such art. The turning point, a fatal error, hits Robin's navel. The only body location Rom finds unstable. The ten-headed fiend's legion is completely defeated. But what now of Sita? Has her life been depleted? All this while, it appears seamless in captivity. In a grove of Ashoka trees, devoid of festivity. Surprisingly, the goddess in despair is a mere phantom. Putting a twist to the story, interesting to fathom. When Sita was abducted, she prayed to the fire god. He gave her protection. For this, we must applaud. Then, an illusory Sita was suddenly manifest. The joke was on Robin. He thought he had the best. But then we wonder, did Ron too get tricked? The drama plays out, so emotions can be gripped. Ron. Sita. Lakshmi. And the 14-year ordeal. Hanuman joins. They return home to Ayodhya to reveal more divine and sweet pastimes of a mystical kind. Tales of Rama are for a happy heart and a happy mind. The end.
Once again, can we show a big round of appreciation? Thank you very much for a live production of your play on this occasion of Ram Navami. And thanks to all these wonderful crew members as well. We'll move to the next part of the program. We'll be having a special arati for our beloved deities here, Sita, Ram, Chandra, Hanuman, and Lakshman. And the arati will be led by Shukrudas.